joining us right now, Senator from my home state. And I was so happy to see him and fellow Senator Eric Schmidt on the floor of State of the Union. I thought, oh, it's Missouri in the House. He joins us now via Skype, Senator Josh Hawley from the wonderful state of Missouri. Good to see you, Senator. Thank you for joining us. Right off the bat, because there's a lot to get into, including some legislation you're going to introduce as well as to the intro music we just played. But this, I know that there's certain things that you can't say, especially if it's a classified briefing. But at least let me ask you this. I know that the Senate has been briefed, and at least you're, I guess, up to date with some of the latest information. Has it clarified anything further for you?
Not really. No, Dana. I mean, my view is that they don't really know what's going on. The Biden administration is completely asleep at the switch, and I don't really know who's in charge. As to these most recent aerial objects that they shot down, the truth is that reports from the Director of National Intelligence that's been declassified has said that there have been hundreds of these kind of objects identified over the last few years. Why the Biden administration started shooting them down just now, I have no idea. They didn't say, they won't tell us. I think part of it is they're embarrassed by the fact that Joe Biden led an honest-to-goodness Chinese spy apparatus across our entire continental United States, including the state of Missouri, and did nothing about it until it had collected everything it wanted to collect. So I think right now they're in total disarray, and they're either completely incompetent or they're lying to us or both.
Yeah, and to your point, New York Times reported yesterday evening that apparently our government knew about this, or the administration knew about this, like right when this balloon or the spy craft lifted off in Chinese I think their Hainan Island. So they monitored it from the beginning. But was Biden aware? Because you posed this question online. You said that he didn't shoot it down over Alaska because the military and intel agencies didn't tell him about it until it had left Alaska. So I'm just curious as to when the president knew and why they didn't then shoot it down in Pacific waters.
Yeah, what's been reported, Dana, is he was not told, and there's public reporting on this, until January 31st, that is days after it had left, the balloon had left Alaska. And you're right, so now we learn that the administration or the intelligence agencies or somebody was tracking this balloon from the second that it left China. They watched it the whole way. They watched it go right over the state of Alaska. The NORAD commander, that's the guy who's in charge of our homeland defense right now, he says that he couldn't shoot it down over Alaska because he personally didn't have authorization, and yet they didn't tell the president. I mean, who's running this country? That's really, to me, the pressing question here. Where is Joe Biden? Yeah. What is he doing?
Does it shock you that he hasn't addressed this personally himself?
Yes, it does, and that's what needs to happen here. Well, we need to know, first of all, that he's actually around and in charge. I mean, is he calling the shots here? Or who, if not, who is? The fact that he wasn't even informed when it was time to make a military decision is pretty shocking.
The vice president, we're talking with Senator Josh Hawley, the vice president had said that she hopes that she doesn't foresee this affecting our relations with Beijing, which I didn't even realize that we had any kind of relations with Beijing to start with. But I really am not getting that sense from China, because they're really saber rattling, making these empty threats towards the United States because we shot down their balloon, which they said was a weather balloon. But, you know, now we know it's spycraft. What are your thoughts on that and how this affects everything with China? Because, I mean, clearly they see that there really wasn't a deterrence.
Well, it should affect our relationship with them, and it ought to be a wake-up call to this administration and all of the people who for years, Dana, have said, oh, China's peaceful. We should do more trade with China. We should send more jobs to China. It's great that they're taking all of our industry. No, it's not. It's been a disaster. Allowing China into the WTO, disaster. Allowing China to build their military on the backs of our middle class, disaster. So what we ought to be doing right now is we ought to be saying, yeah, we're going to change the relationship. We're going to put sanctions on them. We're going to use this as an opportunity to bring back our supply chains to this country and make stuff in America again. That's what we ought to be doing, but that's not what Joe Biden's doing. He's out there doing who knows what. I mean, maybe napping. I don't know. But he's certainly not in charge right now.
Well, apparently making money with business deals. I mean, that's, you know, where I know we're still getting to the bottom of that. I want to one last quick question on this, and I want to switch gears to talk with you about what's happening at St. Louis Children's Hospital. Because I know that they said one spy craft and then the other three were not spy balloons. I mean, what were they?
I don't think they know. And this is where I come back to, Dana. There have been reports now for several years, and this has been declassified information, that there are hundreds of these unidentified aerial objects around sensitive sites around military bases and other places that have been identified, reported by sometimes commercial aircraft, sometimes military aircraft. So they've been, the U.S. government's been tracking this for several years now. There's a bunch of these, and that's really disturbing in its own right. I think we need to be asking, is this part of some bigger espionage program by China or some other country, number one? But number two, now all of a sudden the Biden administration is shooting them down, which is fine if they pose a danger. I just like to know why, and I just like to know what they are.
Yeah.
And the administration won't level with us, either that or they don't know. And either way, it's pretty disturbing.
I think it's amazing. You're a senator, and you and your colleagues, you can't actually tell the American voters what's going on because the administration is not being forthright with you on something as huge as this. That's incredibly significant. Now, in looking at St. Louis, I was shocked to read this story about the, I don't want to call it gender transitioning, it's mutilation that's been taking place with these gender care clinics with regard to St. Louis Children's Hospital, which at Washington University. I mean, when I lived in St. Louis City, I lived right by St. Louis Children's Hospital. I mean, when I worked just in local radio in St. Louis, there were all kinds of things that we did with St. Louis Children's Hospital. This is stunning. And as you know, you've talked quite a bit about this, and I know you're very involved in this. Former case manager, for those unfamiliar, Jamie Reed, who is a Bernie Sanders supporter. This is not a dyed-in-the-wool Republican. She's very left, but she was so troubled by what she saw, the lack of accountability and oversight with regards to these, the gender-affirming care, no address of mental health at all whatsoever. So she's blown the whistle on it. What can be, I'm shocked at the lack of oversight and accountability. This is a major hospital.
Yeah, it is. And the idea that parents would not be told about this, Dana, that they would not know that their kids were being put through these surgeries or sterilized is just sickening. I say as a parent myself of three kids, it is including a baby daughter. It is just sickening. So here's what should happen to begin with. Number one, we ought to give parents the right to sue, and kids, victims, the right to sue these clinics, these doctors, these universities that fund them. All of them ought to be on the hook in court for not just discovery and all that, but damages, big time damages, so that these people who have been victims can be made whole. Number two, we got to figure out every kid who was victimized here. How many of them were there? Who were the doctors who were in charge? Where did the money come from? That's the third piece of it, Dana. Somebody is paying for this. Is it Big Pharma? Is it the insurance monopolies? Is it the government? We are going to find out.
Yeah, this surely isn't informed consent for sure. I mean, I'm just shocked at the ages from reading her affidavit. And of course, Jamie Reed had written a piece on this as well. You bring up a good point. The funding on this, too, where this all comes from. And one of the other things that she touched on, and I'm going to segue into the bill the legislation you're proposing, she was touching on, without getting into it, the social contagion of this transgender movement, and particularly with regards to how it affects teenagers, and very specifically teenage girls. There was just a study from the CDC. I don't give a lot of weight to the CDC. I think boys and girls are having a hard time right now, but there is a major issue with mental health, social contagion, and all of these, it's like five times greater than it ever has been, with kids who are now questioning their identity and wanting medically unnecessary surgeries. Talk a little bit about this threat of this social contagion, because this is where social media comes in.
Well, here's the thing that the whistleblower said that really caught my attention. She said that for many of the young people coming into this clinic, they said that they discovered their gender identity on TikTok. No lie, discover their gender identity on TikTok. I mean, what does that even mean? So this is what we're dealing with here. You've got social media that is shoving this stuff in kids' faces, that is telling kids that if they are depressed or if they are confused or if they are upset, that there's something wrong with them and their gender. I mean, it is really an insane ideology, Dana, and social media is amplifying it big time, which is why we need to take steps to protect kids on social media and also give parents new tools to actually have some control here to be able to protect their kids. And the way I do that is, I'd say that you have to be 16 years old before you can open an account on social media. Let's set that age limit, and let's tell the social media companies they can't come after our kids before then.
I remember Facebook, when they first started, you had to show that you were, I guess, a college student before they opened it up to everybody else. And I'm very intrigued by the tools to give parents, because I have a teenager in my house. My teenager is not on social media, but I also barge into my teenager's room because it's my phone. I pay the cell phone bill. We live in a momtocracy. It is not a democracy. It's actually a momtatorship. And I'll go in and I will take his phone and I will literally read everything. But not every parent does that. And I do think some of it comes down to parenting. What do you say to those people who agree with everything that you said, but they're like, oh, is this an issue of parenting? Is this giving the government too much power? How do you deal with their concerns with that?
I just think that this is an issue of empowering parents. And I get to say that, you know, a father of three, my oldest is 10, and he's not on social media either, hopefully never. But here's the deal. Technology changes so fast. It is hard for parents to keep up. And Dana, I won't lie to you. I mean, my 10-year-old probably knows more about my phone than I know about it. And he certainly doesn't have his own phone. Yeah. But the idea that for most parents that you can, you know, set your settings on your kid's phone and you'll be able to keep track of that, it's virtually impossible. So here's the thing. What a lot of kids will tell you, what studies show, is that kids get on social media at an early age because their friends are on it. It's not necessarily that they really want to be on Instagram. It's that, well, everybody else is, and they don't want to miss out. So I think let's give kids some protection, parents some control. Let's just say you got to be 16. I mean, we're just setting a boundary here to the product. You got to be 16 before you can get on. And we put the verification over on the social media companies. We make them verify. So the burden falls on them. I think it's sensible. I think it is something that will help parents big time and also will really help kids.
I love how this completely and maybe inadvertently totally counters the left's rationalization for wanting to lower the voting age to 16. I love how this just immediately just takes that out at the knees. Senator Josh Hawley, always a pleasure to talk with you. Thanks so much for giving us some time today. We know it's been busy.
Thank you. Take care.